Just a couple items before we start the regular meeting. I had the opportunity to speak last Thursday to the Rotary Club up in Miramar Air Base. Wasn't too well attended. I think it was affected by the fire problems and so forth. But it just constantly reminds me that people just don't understand how to test for the disease and what to do about it. Everyone that was in the room, I had one guy that was very interested in coming for that meeting. He happened to come by chance. The people who are there, first of all, the Rotary Clubs is the right group for us to speak to. And I've now spoken to like four of them, three of them, Lyle's spoken to one. It's the right kind of people to be speaking to and feeding them information. Which you got. I can watch the faces when I'm speaking. They have no idea what to do because they don't, they're waiting for a signal to tell them that they have cancer. And our disease, unfortunately, doesn't work that way. By the time you get a signal, chances are it's too late. So I just took that opportunity to remind you that you have a responsibility and you are our best ambassadors. Our statistics tell us that of all the new people that show, one half of them come here by referral. Another reason to wear these often, because people ask you questions, what's that for? That leads you to the conversation about prostate cancer and leads you to impart information about why it's important. It's much more important these days because, what was it, about a year ago, the Federal Commission ruled that it was no longer necessary to do PSA testing because it increased medical costs and caused overtreatment. Well, there's some truth to that. But it's a twofold problem. One, the medical community, once they find your PSA is escalating and maybe some hints of cancer, but primarily the vehicle is watching your PSA rise quickly. First thing they want to do is do a treatment. And you as a patient, you hear the C word, fine, I got to do something. Okay? That's the real problem. If you don't do testing, how are you ever going to know? That's the hard part of this question. Don't wait till you feel pain. Once in a while, if you have a BPH, a swelling of the prostate that causes constriction of the urethra, you have difficulty urinating, frequent urinating and so forth, that's kind of a hint that you've got problems, but that's not necessarily leading to cancer. I had it like a couple of years before my cancer. But it isn't a precursor to cancer necessarily. So that's about the only signal that people think we have prostate cancer coming. So enough said, I'll get off my soapbox. Just help us out because it's really, really difficult to get guys in here that haven't already been biopsied or to make them understand what to do to find out if they've got a problem with cancer. That in mind, I want to remind you again, on our website, there's a button called Personal Experiences, and mine's there, George is there, quite a few guys are there. It's a very good way to find out what people have done about their experience and how they have treated their disease. I'd like to get more participation. I know a lot of guys don't want to do it because they don't think they can write. Take advantage of me and give me some notes and I'll help you write it up. But I'd like to see more participation in that. It's very useful. And I want to tell you, we're getting a lot of more participation in our website now. And John, our webmaster, knows this as well as I do when I was in business. The more people that look at your website, the more available, the more quickly it becomes available to those that are just browsing. If you're browsing for prostate cancer, our name now comes up more readily than it did before. And I'm getting a lot of calls based on just somebody looking on our website. Even better, we have a book in the library by Dr. Jay Cohen, who's a friend of many of us here, called Prostate Cancer Breakthroughs. And in his last edition, the 2014 edition, he mentions our group because that's what started him to do research, to find out when he published in his book. And in the last edition, he mentioned our support group, our phone number, my name, and I'm getting calls from throughout the country now because of that. So anything you can do to get out the word, because if we help one guy, we've done a wonderful job. So enough said on that. Some of you probably noticed in the newsletter, I published an article from a gentleman in Mesa, Arizona, talking about the problems he experienced in being put in the hospital for observation, and found out that it was not paid for by Medicare. And it caused one gentleman to take exception to the way it was presented and so forth as being politically inclined, and sent me a phone message and then an email about it. And I did call him, we talked about it a little bit, and I wanted to offer him a chance to talk today if you're here. Are you here today, Jeff? Guess not, I guess maybe that answers that. So wanted him to present his side, that he thought that there was some political intonation in the newsletter that wasn't appropriate for our group. I don't believe so. The important message to me was whether or not observation in the hospital is covered by Medicare or not. And everything I can see says it's not. If you put in there the treatment, yes, it's going to be covered. So I thought it was a pretty good message. So enough, I'll get off my soapbox, turn it over to George Johnson, who always does a wonderful job on facilitating, and go away. George,
thank you. Thank you.
Hi, how's everybody doing?
Good.
You doing good? What a wonderful day. Guess what the name of our group is?
Informal.
Look at that. What's the name of the group?
Informed.
We got a special meeting today. We got a bunch of experts going to speak to you. These are not medical experts, but they're patient experts. We're all patient. Some of us are impatient patients. But we kind of have what you might consider a consumer's report today. We've got people who have tested the cars or tested the treatment and have a lot of experience. And they want to share with you. And you know, we're not here to give you medical advice. We're here to give you maybe questions you want to ask your doctor. We're not doctors, but there's some good questions you may want to ask. And what I learned in talking to some doctors, I'll ask them about something I learned here, and the doctor says, yeah, we could do that. Rather than let's do it, it's, yeah, we could do that, and it turns out in my case it worked. So ask questions. That's one of the things about being informed. We try to help you be informed about the questions. Okay, now these are your hosts, these are your volunteers, these are patient experts. They're very knowledgeable about things. We have over 80 years of patient prostate cancer experience. So I'd like our panel here, this is not the panel at the table, but your host here to tell a quick review of where they stand with their prostate cancer. And let's start with Lyle.
Hi guys, good morning. I graduated, I moved from prostate cancer to throat cancer. So I don't worry about my prostate anymore. But what actually happened was 14 years ago, I was diagnosed like most of you and with a random biopsy, because I was sent to the urologist by my general practitioner to get my PSA going on. And so that's the problem that we're trying to correct today. Just because your PSA goes up a little bit, you don't have to go in and have a biopsy. Because once you get a biopsy, as Gene said, they have to treat you. Now, for all the new people that are here today, I just want to tell you to take one thing, that it's going to be confusing, it's going to be contradictory, there are people going to tell you to do one thing or another thing, and I can write down in front of you on a board 16 different ways to treat prostate cancer. 16. So which one is best for you? We're getting to the point where through genomics, they're going to be able to tell you what kind of prostate cancer you have, because there are more than one kind of prostate cancer. And when we get to that point, we'll be able to really cure it. But in the meantime, for all you new people, I met a guy, Paul Potash, on the phone a couple weeks ago. And after talking to him for a while, he understood that you can't get excited, you can't start running. And don't do what somebody thinks that they did worked for them. Do your own research, come to these meetings, and you're going to be able to solve your own problems. But don't get confused. If you get confused, don't rush into something. And that's my message of the day.
Next, we have our vice president for operations, and we have a requirement. You had to have an operation to be vice president. And now, here's a gentleman that has four treatments, so he's got a lot of experience. He's going to be on the panel on his fourth one, a new one. But here's a guy with a real record of activity.
I'm not going to take any more time with it, because I will be a part of the panel, and I'll give you a little rundown of my situation then.
Bill Manning is not with us today, but we have our Unit B camera director and also our webmaster, John. Come on down.
Come on.
This is an opportunity for you to turn around and look at the camera and get on the disc.
Good morning. My name is John Tassi. Today is a very special day for me. 5 years ago today was my last chemo infusion. So I am 5 years out. PSA is still zero. Some of you know I've been through all the treatments. I had surgery, came back. So that's when I went in for radiation, chemo, and androgen therapy. And after all that's completed, it's been about 4.5 years. So I have 6 months to go since my last full treatment. And that's going to be a big milestone. But today is kind of fun. I think back, Gene, you remember seeing me.
Yeah.
I had to walk in on crutches because I was down from 220 pounds to about 160, walking on crutches, and I had to have special shoes because of the neuropathy. So I've come a little bit further than that, and I'm here today, and it's really good to see all the smiling faces. Thank you.
Did you have chemo and the androgen hormone therapy both, or are you calling the chemo the leukemia?
No, I had both.
Both.
I had 13 months of androgen therapy.
13 months. That sucks.
Thank you.
And next, our librarian, who's very informed, and he's got how many years of experience?
21.
Okay.
Hi, in 1992, there was an ad in the newspaper, get a free PSA test from this hospital. So I went for one, found out my initial PSA was 21, so I went to a radiologist and a urologist, decided on surgery. It turned out my Gleason was 6. And had the surgery, and then 6 months later, my PSA started rising. As it turned out, something got left behind in my prostate bed. So I decided, after seeing a Dr. Bob Leibowitz in Los Angeles 20 years ago, that I want to try his approach rather than what my local oncologist, urologist was recommending. So I've been on androgen deprivation therapy or hormone therapy ever since. So I started out with the substances that were in use in those days, but now the ones I use are Casodex and Evodart. So I'm on intermittent hormone blockade. My PSA, when I'm using both of those substances, goes down to 0.0 something, and I stop the Casodex. My PSA rises over about a year or a year and a half to six. At that point, I've decided I won't let it go any higher in agreement with my oncologist, and I start the Casodex again. My PSA goes down to 0.0 something, and then I do this, keep doing this cycle. I've been doing this cycle now for 20 years, and so far it's working with me. Recently, at the recommendation of Dr. Lamb, I started taking metformin. And I'm taking that now for 4 months, and it shows that it's slowed the rate of rise of my PSA. I don't know how significantly yet, but there's a definite change in the rate of rise of my PSA. So far, so good. That's it.
Good news and a good example.
Every 3 months.
Every 3 months,
yes.
Okay, next. Welcome.
I'm Jim DeGreeter. I've been here for about 5 years. I was diagnosed about almost 6 years. Gleason 7, PSA of 4. I sort of panicked and I went into radiation right away, coupled with hormonal therapy. They wanted me to do it for 2 years. I just did it for one because it made me really feel crappy. But anyway, that regimen worked, and my PSA was just eliminated, undetectable. And apparently, the radiation killed all the cancer cells, although who knows. But anyway, I had no signs whatsoever, an undetectable PSA for several years. But I was still feeling down, you know, and no energy, listless, no libido, and kept on asking my urologist about my testosterone. So we tested that, and it was one. I mean, one, the number one, you know. And they called that hypogonadism, something like that. And I, you know, what the hell was that? Nobody ever said anything about my testosterone levels. Testosterone is sort of like a dirty word with prostate cancer. We just got to eliminate it, suppress it. I mean, that's what the hormonal therapy is for. But they don't tell you that a low testosterone may cause prostate cancer, and I'm a believer of that. So, in any event, after all these successful treatments for prostate cancer, I still felt poor. So, you know, the testosterone indicated to me that that was why. But they wouldn't allow me, my urologist wouldn't write a prescription for it. He said something like, well, let's wait 4 or 5 years, and if you're still undetectable with PSA, then we'll go. Well, I waited 4 or 5 years, and a year and a half ago, that moment came, and I started testosterone replacement therapy. Best thing I ever did. I had a blood draw. 2 weeks ago, my testosterone is over 1,000. My PSA is going down from 0.3 to 0.2. It's pretty low anyway, but the trend is going down rather than going up. So I am a happy patient here. I got, you know, I'm doing so-called risky treatment, but it's turning out, I don't think it's risky at all. There's a big myth that's being punctured that testosterone replacement therapy is detrimental to cancer recovery. And I don't believe that. We have some tapes here. Dr. Leibowitz has got long-term studies about testosterone replacement therapy and cancer recovery. So I'm a happy patient, and I'm doing something considered risky, but I'm going to continue doing it because it makes me feel good.
Thank you, John. If you want to know more about this controversy about testosterone, it's on our website. There's a doctor who found some years back that he was treating people who had low testosterone, men who had low testosterone. Turned out they had a high incidence of prostate cancer.
which is very puzzling. And it goes against some of the old training that the doctors have had. Testosterone causes cancer and so forth. Lack of it can cause cancer. So if you want to find out more about it, it's on our website. Look it up. Thank you. One other person, and I guess that's me, and I've had prostate cancer for 16 years. It was 16 years ago I had a PSA. I didn't ask for it. It was just given by the doctor. And on the lab report, he put a note on, I think you have prostate cancer, go see a urologist. So I do what I'm told, and I did, and he wanted to do surgery, and I learned a lot, and I didn't have it. I had what was then called radiation, EBRT. It worked great for 10 years, and then it came back, and it came back with a vengeance. It doesn't necessarily go away with some people. And I'm one of the 15% who have prostate cancer that's extremely aggressive. I got at least in the vein everywhere and also in my seminal vesicle. But I'm on ADT and I've learned a lot in this group. I became informed. One of the things that I wanted to commend Gene about and also Lyle is they're very talented and gifted in tracking the medical profession and what doctors might be good speakers to this group. And I go see them. And I went to see Dr. Bond. You've heard that name before. He does targeted biopsy, which is key. And then Gene found a person by the name of Fabio Almeida a couple of years ago who does the new Sylvan trials. It's very effective. Carbon 11 acetate. And I had that done, and it really helped me. My cancer has not spread. And he spoke here at our last meeting. I asked him a question, because one of my doctors suggested I have a sodium fluoride test. And he said, yes, that's a good idea, and I did. And that was Dr. Kipper, who was our speaker in January. A very, very good doctor, very calm. Okay, and he asked me a question, what are you doing? The first time I had a doctor ask me that, what are you doing? Because he was basically amazed at my progress. I'm 81 years old. On the Kaplan-Meier's chart, I shouldn't be here, and so forth. So I'm a special case because I'm under some special treatment that's not the norm, and it works for me. He wanted to know what it is. And so I told him, he's a very good guy, and the news is all good, and I have a baseline, and if need be, I'll have another test. So I'm in good shape, and so let's move on. There's an element here I want to read to you from our website. Here's the newsletter, and it says, from a member here, it says, right now I'm having amnesia and deja vu. And what that does, it says, I'm having it at the same time. I think I've forgotten this before. So with that in mind, I'm going to quickly go through the things that you've heard before and may have forgotten, but I want to remind you, where you're newcomers, please fill out the yellow form and bring it up here. If you don't have one, get one from Jim. And you'll get a call from our friend here, Gene, who will offer any help that you might need. A reminder, and it's particularly true for today, we're not doctors. We're not a substitute for your doctors. We have experience we'd like to share with you so you become a better case manager. We need your support, and this is time to pass the baskets. We're a 501c3, so you can save on your taxes by giving us your money. And we have small baskets, that's why we want big bills. Bills with zeros on it are really appreciated. We're not affiliated with any doctors or religious organizations, but almost all of us on the volunteers have gone to the doctors that have spoken here. Otherwise, we wouldn't have them here. We pick the good doctors and we test them out, and we benefit from that. So that's something for you to consider, and a good idea for you to get our past this. From previous doctors that are speaking.
Thank you.
We have a website On today's website, we have Snuffy Myers talking about when should you have surgery. That changes every week, so check it out. We have over there, look at that table, full of information. So if you want to be informed, get a disc, and or get a book, you can rent some and you can buy some. Gene's already talked about the importance of outreach. What we do, as a reminder, Gene and I have given talks this past week, or past month, two groups. One I was in a retirement community, and Gene at Rotary. So we're, if you have any suggestions for us to spread the word, let us know. Pick up a business card there, put your name on it, and if you want to purchase one of these blue bands, please do so. The newsletter is full of information. In there is this point about that Gene brought up on how to deal with the Medicare situation, which is changing things. Also, Dr. Schultz has an article in there on the various treatments and the whole process of diagnostic, and also some attempts at humor. Even has a couple of cartoons here for you. So check that out. We have monthly meetings. Look what's coming up. We have a very interesting one. We have two for one, two Goldsteins for one visit. And we've got one on the sexual medicine and also on stem cell research. That's next month. And following that, some very important information on new technology related to detection and targeting of biopsies. So make sure you hit these. Now what we're going to do is, oops, let's do a little survey first before we go to our agenda items. I want you to raise your hand, get some exercise. How many are here for the first time? Look at that. Welcome. Welcome. Now, let me say, how many have been recently diagnosed in the last 6 months with prostate cancer? You're also welcome. Now, how many have had prostate cancer for up to 1 year? If you're there, how many have had from up to 4 years? Look at that. And then 5 to 10 years, what used to be called survivors. All right. Anybody 11 to 15? We're getting kind of a flat curve, aren't we, here? Above 15, I got 16, I'll raise my hand. Anybody, look at that hand go up there. Anybody else? And how many years?
21.
Yeah. 21, he's our record holder for today. Gets a special award.
Yes.
Okay, anybody higher than 21? Next year we'll have one higher than 21. Let's do a treatment survey. Now, if you had any of these treatments, raise your hand each time you've had one, and you'll watch Gene's hand go up four or more times. How many have had surgery of all kinds of the prostate? Okay, look around at you there. Okay, now how many have had radiation of all types? Maybe a couple more than surgery. This is a trend that's changing here. How many are on ADT or hormone therapy? Look at that. Okay. How many are on chemotherapy? One, two, and we had one that's now off of it. You're all welcome, of course. How many are now on active surveillance without previous treatment? This is their first active surveillance. See, that's the good news. Now, all of you should be on active surveillance now that you've had treatment, because you want to avoid recurrence. How many are on new technology? We got, we're going to hear about cryo. Anybody have HIFU, Provenge? What you got?
I have Provenge therapy.
Good, yeah. Good. Let's see. How many have had, like me, recurrence, it came back. They look at that. That's the profile of this disease, is that you live long enough, which we all will, it may come back. That's why you want to keep getting those PSAs. I get mine every 3 months. How many are undecided about treatment? How many undecided? You're here to, so I think you'll find some interesting things on our panel to consider and some questions to ask your doctor about that. But the whole thing about decision making that tends not to be emphasized by doctors is the side effects, and the impact on quality of life. So now here's our agenda. And after that, we're going to have networking, and I'll talk about that when we get to that point. In order. Darrel, you want to start us off on cryoablation and what led you up to that and what stimulated to try it out and what are the results and lessons learned? Are we live yet? I think so.
Thank you. Fellow members of the Informed Prostate Group, I thought it'd be best to provide you with a backstory leading up to my eventual cryosurgery performed by Dr. Bond in May of 2013. During the last quarter of 2011, having evaluated several products, I electively began taking a bioidentical testosterone supplement manufactured in Australia by Lolly Pharmaceutical. The name is Androforte, the medication. My T level had been fluctuating between about 100 and 300 for several years, and I experienced the typical low T symptoms, general lethargy, low libido, weight increase, and poor muscle tone. My PSA score, which had been relatively stable at between 2 and 3 for an extended period of time, began to climb shortly after I began the protocol. I have a large prostate, so it's never been down to some of the levels I hear around here, 0.1, you know. It had been stable between 2 and 3 and began to climb shortly after I began the protocol. In April of 2012, it rose to 6.30, and by January, my PSA hit 9.7. I'm reasonably certain that the cancer was present preceding my introduction of testosterone supplements and that my tumor growth was accelerated due to the steroid. The VA hospital performed the 12 needle biopsy in July of 2012 after I had visited one of their staff urologists. One needle confirmed that to be positive, and after analysis was found to have a Gleason rating of 3-4, or intermediate stage disease. The urologist suggested we schedule a radical prostatectomy at my leisure and provided literature describing the procedure. It was a very bleak period at that point in my life. Fortunately, I've heard about this group, the Ipcsg, having open meetings once a month in La Jolla, and decided to attend. As a result, having met many gracious and knowledgeable people, I began to adopt a more optimistic attitude concerning my predicament. Books such as Invasion of the Prostate Snatchers, Cancer Breakthroughs, and many magazines provided during these meetings were highly beneficial in my seeking a solution. At about the same time, the VA did orchestrate my meeting with a radiation oncologist to explain the merits of IMRT, the radiation. But I was finally drawn to one of two procedures. The first, HIFU, or high-intensity focused ultrasound, where heat is used as an instrument for cell destruction, has great popularity in Europe and China, apparently. But it's not approved in the United States. And apparently in HIFU, there are two competing machines. One is made in the US and the other one is made in Europe. Both of them are highly automated, pre-programmed, and then kind of let go. The operator sort of stays in the background during that procedure. By the way, the US model is called a sonoplate, and it is approved for some other types of of cancer. In any case, the second option was cryoablation, using cold as the method of destruction. And in late January 2013, I met with Dr. Duke Bond to be our evaluator for cryosurgery. He performed a Doppler ultrasound followed by a targeted needle biopsy of seven suspected areas within my prostate. The doctor made the comment that the VA had missed more than a few tumors during their original biopsy, but assuming that the castor had not metastasized, I would be a good candidate for cryoablation. In mid-March, I was able to visit Dr. Scholes, an oncologist at his Marina Del Rey facility, for a second opinion into the best course of action. He ordered an MRI and a bone scan through the Imaging Healthcare Labs in San Diego, and concurred with Dr. Bond's assessment regarding cryoablation as being a viable option. He also suggested that since I had a history of cardiac problems, that a spinal be used as opposed to a general anesthetic, if possible, to reduce my risks. By mid-April, the results from both scans were found to be negative, and I was lined up for the procedure. So on May 15, the cryoablation was performed by Drs. Bond and Silverman at the Memorial Hospital in Ventura. And initially, the doctors are going to perform a focused cryoablation targeting the known tumors, decided it was in my best interest to target the whole right side of the prostate to ensure that even small formations would be eradicated. He was aware that I wished to continue testosterone therapy if possible going forward. I was released the next day, saddled with a catheter in a bag, which I was able to remove 1 week later. Later that year, I reintroduced a testosterone supplement, and in mid-December 2013 had a follow-up ultrasound performed by Dr. Bond. He found no evidence of recurrent malignancy in either lobe, and so I intend to continue with periodic ultrasound evaluations every 6 months with Dr. Bond unless he says they are no longer needed.
Okay, do we have, let's limit it to three questions on cryo. Any questions?
I have one. You mentioned that you went to the VA hospital. Does the VA cover the cryo procedure, or was that?
I'm under Medicare, and so it would have been covered in either case, but it was covered under Medicare. But they didn't get involved.
Oh, Medicare. Aspect. Oh, good. All right, thank you.
Don't look that old.
Thanks.
Any other questions?
Practitioner and the everybody wants to hear your
voice. I wondered if there were any practitioners in San Diego area that do cryo.
Not that we know of yet. There is, by the way, a doctor in UCLA or in Los Angeles that was trained by Dr. Bond, also performs HIFU in Mexico, in Tijuana. So he was taught how to do cryo, but he also is well acquainted with the other procedure. And so some people will elect to go down there, apparently, and have that done the other way. Slightly less invasive, HIFU is.
You know, the only other cryo that we're aware of is Dr. Ukimura up at
George.
USC.
George.
Cryo is much like surgery in that it is the skill of the operator in placing the frozen probes. So when you ask if there's someone in San Diego that does it, they might have done it, but you don't want to go there. So if anybody's in cryo, I think cryo is, focal cryo is really a great procedure if you go to the right guy.
Absolutely, and Dr. Bond is the guru in that regard.
Could you tell us about the side effects? Did you have any noteworthy side effects?
You mean after being released with the bag, and very little. There was blood in my urine for a while, but nothing really horrendous after the procedure.
Okay, no long-term side effects.
Not that I know of.
Okay, let's hear from our next panel.
My name is Ruben Aguinaga. I'm 56 years old, and prior to 2014, I had no, wasn't even thinking about prostate cancer. I started going, asking my doctor about typical levels of lower hormone. And from that discussion, we started monitoring my PSA levels. So at the beginning of this year, my PSA level was rising from, monitoring it from, let's say, late summer to beginning of this year, it climbed from like a 3.8 to a 5.0. And then I had biopsy done on January 22nd and found out that I had a Gleason 8 cancer, and contacted this prostate group and got a lot of good information. I went to three different doctors for opinions, and went with the radical prostatectomy. The radical prostatectomy was done on last Thursday, May 8th, and I think everything turned out well. They had bilateral nerve sparing and no detection of cancer in the lymph nodes or in the testicles or the testicles. So
you're happy with it.
So far, so good.
Was this robotic surgery?
Da Vinci.
Where was it done?
It was UCSD by Dr. Chris Kane. It was done at the Hillcrest UCSD Memphis.
I have not. I'm still.
Okay.
Just got diagnosed a month ago, so I'm looking at all. When it was removed, they do further testing. Is that what you're talking about? They found nothing after the
removal. They do the pathology then, and
right.
that was one of the reasons. One of the reasons that that I chose to do the radical prostatectomy because it was a Gleason 8. I think Dr. Payne, when I consulted with him, or consulted with me, indicated that if it was a Gleason 7, he probably would be, advising me to take radiation or radical prostatectomy with an 8. The reason is that we would know for sure upon the removal what we're dealing with, whereas with the radiation, it's a 2-year period, because I think with the, kind of getting into the details of what they were recommending, but if I had done radiation treatment, which would have been a brachy combination, brachy with proton beam, would have been a 2-month period with the proton beam. The brachy is a 1-day turnaround, and so the 2-year is with the testosterone block. And I really wanted to have no part of testosterone block, because that's really the reason I went in to see a doctor, because my levels were low, certainly not a level of 1 like I heard here, but mine were high 200s to mid 200s, and that was not okay. I couldn't see myself going through 2 years of a block. So, and then that coupled with the Gleason 8, that coupled with Dr. Kane being a pretty good expert on it, and he's done, I think if you look at his information I have from him is that he does 200 procedures per year. So he's very good, and I definitely, I'm sitting here after having radical prostatectomy last May 8th, so pretty good.
Is he the only physician at UCSD that you've seen? We're looking to make a change. But
no.
Did you start with UCSD, and Dr. Kane is a surgeon there, but...
He's one of the urologists. He's one of them. I did see an oncologist, and that was because in my discussions with Dr. Kane, Dr. Kane came here in February, and I actually was my first visit here at that time, having just been diagnosed 2 weeks before that. So very much a newbie, didn't know what was going on, and he definitely seemed very confident. And then the other thing that caught my ear was that he was going through clinical trials for a virus that would combat prostate cancer. However, the criteria was you had to have a Gleason 7, and I was running because I had Gleason 8. So anyway, that caught my attention. That's why I went to him, and I think I made the right decision because of the certainty of the procedure, as much as possible. Ms. Jen?
Since you're recently out of your surgery, how are your side effects now, incontinence?
Yeah, incontinence, I got to tell you, it's a good story. Really, it's a good story because I was able to, the catheter was removed yesterday.
Oh, wow.
And immediately was able to go to the restroom. I can control my bladder. So it's a really good story. Also, what had been told to me was that because of, I'm relatively young, I guess, for having prostate cancer, in relatively good shape, so that contributed to the outcome. But the next step is sexual aspect of it, and I'm feeling very positive about that because he did have bilateral nerve sparing, and Dr. King is pretty good at the procedure, and he actually said that it came out quite well. So it was a good procedure. I think I made the right decision, and I think four different opinions is what I based my decision on.
From the readings, I'm looking at doing the removal myself, the Da Vinci at Balboa Hospital. Mm-hmm. My doctors perform a couple hundred of surgeries. Why do they say you need 4 to 6 weeks off from work? They recommend 4 to 5 weeks off from work? You look pretty good. You're in good shape to go to work now.
I
know why they say that. That's the recommended. I got to time it.
Yeah, I don't think my doctor advised me on how long I was supposed to be out from work. He did say that 6 weeks of no lifting anything above 5 pounds, and you can't get into a jacuzzi or a swimming pool for 4 to 6 weeks or 6 weeks. So, but certainly not anything, stay away from work.
Well, I'm 53 and I'm a runner. I run 5 miles every other day, so I think that I'm hoping that helps me.
What is your Gleason?
Six.
Six? I wouldn't do it.
Well, I'm just going to do this. We don't know we're doing this.
No. Again, the only reason, in my personal opinion, is it was an 8.
I'm just going for follow-up. Don't know what I'm doing next.
Okay. Yeah. I wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
Anyway, go ahead.
When they did the surgery, did they remove the lymph nodes?
No. No, I think what they did is they took a little sample from the lymph nodes and also from the vas deferens and then the testicles, and they did that for the bone marrow, for the pathology.
Another question is, did you have a bone scan?
Yes.
Yeah.
So a biopsy was the 22nd of January. A week later, the 29th, I got results back. By the way, my pathology from the biopsy was, I had a second opinion on that. First of all, I went to Boswick, which I guess is a big pathology lab. And then we had a second opinion for the pathology, and that was sent to Johns Hopkins, Dr. Epstein, who I think is pretty well known. And they both came back the same thing. And as a matter of fact, the pathology from the prostate indicated it was a 4-4 Gleason. And I actually had another tumor in there, but it was a 6.
Okay, let's hear about active surveillance. All right, hopefully I can answer some questions for some of you guys that have been asking this. My name's Larry Smith, active surveillance at 56. So I'm going to be just about the opposite of what this young man did. However, I think at a Gleason 8, I might have done the same thing he did and probably had surgery. Mine was a Gleason 6. So, and I had 1 out of the 12 cells that they actually found positive, and that was 4 years ago. So originally, my dad had prostate cancer at 65, he had radiation, he's 80 today, he's still alive, PSA is 0.0 whatever, so he's somewhat cured, I guess. So when he was 65 and found out he had prostate cancer, I was 42, and that's when I started checking my PSA. Back then, I had a 2.0 at 42, which in my opinion, I thought was a little high. And over the next 3 years at 45, I had a 3.5. I still, at that point, didn't do anything. I went to a couple different doctors. They had conflicting opinions, what should be done. I didn't want to do a biopsy, so I waited. Over the course of the next 10 years, it ranged anywhere from 2.5 to 3.5. And at 56, I went ahead and got a biopsy. I had a doctor I was seeing, a urologist, who I think 3 years in a row said,
You need to get a biopsy. You need to get a biopsy. So I finally went ahead and went in and got one done. Again, one out of 12 cells. And the urologist I saw, she said, you need to get surgery right away. And I said, no, I want to research this a little bit. For the next 3 weeks, she called me. She said, you're taking your life in your hands. You're playing Russian roulette. You're going to die. I've seen guys like you die 6 months later. And after the third call, I told her, don't ever call me again. You're fired. So picked her out, and I sought three other top doctors, one at City of Hope, Dr. Timothy Wilson, who he's a surgeon. He said, I'm a candidate for active surveillance, although he's a surgeon, suggested surgery, but said I could do the other. I went to Loma Linda, checked into proton therapy. Same thing there. I was candidate for proton therapy, but also active surveillance, at my decision, after some research. And then I went to UCSD, where I've been seeing Dr. Kellogg Parsons, for 2 years now. And I'm actually on what's called a Mills study over there, where they have a nutritionist call me once a month. I eat better, I exercise, they kind of keep me to a schedule. I get my PSA done every 3 months. I've never had another biopsy, 4 years now. And my PSA, which interesting to me is my PSA will start to rise. And I would think if you had prostate cancer, it would keep going up and up and up and up. But when it drops back down to a 2, to me, it's just weird. So how can you have cancer? How can it be growing if your PSA is falling back down again? But our bodies are always fighting it too. So I think I'm keeping it in check, and I do eat better. I'm not vegan. I'm not 100% like I should be, maybe. But I think everything's in moderation. So, you know, I eat more fruits, more vegetables, a little less red meat. I don't exercise as much as I should, but I try to watch my health, and I think that's helping. So anyway, last year, mine shot up to a 4.87, and I was really concerned. But Dr. Parsons said not to worry about it. He looks at it over a year and says, you're still an average around a 3-something. He says, I wouldn't worry about it. Well, I was worried, so I went over to Loma Linda. They did an MRI, because I didn't want a biopsy again. And my MRI there came back that it had spread to my seminal vesicles, and I was now stage 3, and it was in a lot more places, and I was scared to death. I thought, you know, what did I do? I shouldn't have waited, right? Well, I talked to Dr. Parsons. He just couldn't believe with my PSA that low that it could have spread. He said, I don't believe it. Have another MRI done here at UCSD, which I did. It turns out, too, I went to the proton radiologist at Loma Linda, and he told me that the guy there who actually reads the MRI, he said he wouldn't trust him. Oh. He actually told me that. He said he's the same situation like mine. People go to UCLA and find out there's nothing wrong. Whoa. So I go to UCSD, have the MRI done. The radiologist reads it there. And by the way, he only reads prostate cancer MRIs. So all he reads all day long. He's a top one. They actually recruited him from UCLA. So he said, nope, it's not your seminal vesicles. It hasn't spread. You're low-grade disease. And he read Loma Linda's report and said the same thing. He goes, I don't know what the guy's looking at, but he's wrong. So anyway, I didn't do anything, and I felt a lot better. And then my PSA dropped back down to 2.5. So I think what I'm doing is right, and if I can give you guys any advice at all, every doctor is just an opinion. They're just people like the rest of us. Go and get checked out to at least 2, if not 3 doctors. Don't make a fast decision. Unless maybe you're Gleason 8. That's a whole different story. You know, I might have been in a different situation, but being a Gleason 6, all the research I did, I spent 2 years myself reading everything I can, doing everything possible, and again, everyone is different. Everyone's cancer is going to be different. Every doctor has a different opinion. I think there's no rush unless it's spread and you're in a bad situation, but if you just found out you had it, and it's not that bad, I would definitely research and I would do active surveillance. And again, at my age, at 53, when I found out I had it, most of the doctors would say, you're young, you need to get it out right now because it's going to be aggressive. And I don't believe that. And the more and more I'm seeing that more and more hospitals and doctors are pushing for active surveillance. So I think what I'm doing is the right thing. I also did send my pathology also over to Johns Hopkins.
And my original pathology found it in 1 out of 12 cells, 30% contained Gleason 6. And I thought, you know, that's so small. Why is it anything to even worry about? It's like a little pin of cancer, right? So I sent it to John Hopkins. It comes back. That same cell had cancer. Another one was suspicious, and 3 more were high-grade pen. But and I was 40% contained in that one. So now I was a little worried again. But at the same time, showing all these 3 specialists, my reports from both hospitals or from Johns Hopkins and looking at it, they all agreed I'm a candidate for active surveillance. So I eat better, I pray a lot, and so far I'm good.
That's a great story. I'm sure you got good questions. The real theme here is get a second opinion.
Yep.
A person in the same situation, the surgeon wanted to do it, and he asked for to get a second opinion, and this person said, you don't have time for a second opinion. You always have time for a second opinion.
Well, that's what the first question.
Okay, questions?
George, I'd like to ask the gentleman, have you checked your testosterone during all of these ups and downs?
Yes, I've been to rheumatologist, endocrinologist. I've had all my hormones done from every hormone test and checked there is. I've had my testosterone checked twice now. It's usually around, it's been 350 to 500. So I think it's in the middle of where it should be. In fact, I was gonna ask you, are you doing the bioidentical hormone? You're doing bioidentical. My wife swears by those. She does the bioidentical hormones, and she says that's a great thing, and she's all for testosterone treatment. And you know, she looks at that other side, like what you're looking at is, you know, when these guys are young and they don't have prostate cancer, they have high testosterone. And then we get older and it drops down and we get prostate cancer, so it makes sense that you need your testosterone boost. But that goes against everything in the medical field, so it's, you know, controversial.
What are bioidentical testosterone?
I think she uses like yams, it's a gel and stuff. I don't know, it's not, they're like real hormones.
Oh.
It's bioidentical from plant,
all right.
From plant material.
That's just a fancy name for
exactly.
Okay.
Questions here.
Hi, I had the Da Vinci operation in VA in La Jolla. I'm 57 years old. And my numbers went from 0 to a year and a half later to a Gleason of 9. It went from 2 to 4 to 9. And they called it high grade. And I tried to find out the terminology that they were using, calling it high grade. Has anybody ever heard that?
Your Ipcsg metaphors, in other words, Gleason ratings are different from PSA ratings, obviously. So
what is your PSA?
Well, my combination numbers were 9.
That's the Gleason.
That's
so yeah, Gleason.
My PSA, I forget what it was.
Okay, a 9 Gleason?
Yeah, it was a 5 and a 4.
I question that.
4+5. Get a second.
4+5, yeah. And they used the term because they also had it when they went in for surgery, they had to take out one of the veins that allowed for the blood to have an erection. That's how fast it was spreading. And they used the term high grade, and I went and tried to research, and I couldn't. I guess it might be a slang terminology that the medical profession uses.
I think they mean you're aggressive.
I was diagnosed at UCSD with a 5+4. By Dr. Kane, and that it's high grade on all my computer printouts. I did the radiation because of my age. In fact, Dr. Kane, the Gleason 9, and because I was 75 or 6, he suggests, he just threw me to the radiation room. I never really understood why, but maybe it's the age.
I agree. Your question, to you,
yes.
The question to you is, so you had radical prostatectomy,
right.
And then afterwards, you're monitoring your PSA levels. What were the PSA levels, 0 to 1?
Well, I had it done in January, and then I had my recent, every 3 months, in March, they did the blood work again, and they just told me that it checked out good.
Okay.
So I'm kind of new at it. I mean, everything happened so fast. I went from a number of 2, and then 6 months later, the VA checked me, went to 4. And then 8 months later, they checked me and it went to 9. And then all of a sudden, October, I had the biopsy, and they were able to get me into surgery in January. So for me, it just happened with so super fast.
PSA is going back to the
I'm kind of young at it, even though I just had the operation grown.
You do bring up an important point in case management. Get a copy of all your lab reports. They're your report. You can get those. Put them in a notebook so you can see what actually is occurring and check that out.
That's important.
Other question here?
Thank you. One thing I've hard to understand, does a Gleason, let's say a Gleason 6, change to a Gleason 7 or a Gleason 8 as the disease progresses? Or does it always remain a Gleason 6 and just spreads as a Gleason 6?
It tends to rise. The thing about a Gleason is an accumulation of 2 readings. And a 3 plus 3 is a 6. A 3 plus 4 is a 7, and then there's a higher 7 where it's a 4 plus 3. So the more predominant one comes first. And then it proceeds to grow from there without treatment or anything.
Is it the same type of cancer, or is it just a more advanced or a different type of cancer?
It's a prostate cancer.
Through molecular testing and genetic testing? The newest thing out is genetic testing, and they're learning that there are multiple kinds of prostate cancer, and that's going to be beyond the Gleason, so they're going to be able to diagnose you more completely than just using the Gleason score. And generally speaking, the reason that the Gleason changes is because they tend to find the center of the cancer. So that when you do a targeted biopsy, you get a much better idea of what your true Gleason is, because a doctor like Bond will take it straight from the center of the tumor, where the other guy just hit it by accident. So when you have recurring prostate cancer, the reason it comes back so strongly is because that they didn't get the toughest part of it. So your Gleason score doesn't tend to change if you just tend to find it better.
Hi there, I was diagnosed in 2008 with a Gleason 9 and I had a PSA of 10. I went through the whole gamut of talking to surgeons and radiation and so on and so on. And my opinion on all that was that each one wanted to help the very best way he could, and the very best way he could was within his profession and his experience. Anyway, I elected to go for hormones. First hormone shot brought my PSA from 10 down to 2.5, and somewhere in my research I'd read that your hormones will become less effective as time goes by, so I elected to not take them in 90-day periods, but to stretch it out to where my PSA indicated I might be eligible again. It turned out to be a year. So in 2009, I took another, it got up to about 5. I elected to take another shot. And that went a year, and then another year, and now I'm down to where the PSA rises very quickly, but very small amounts. But the significant thing to me is that the shots that I'm taking do not drop the PSA like they did initially. The last shot dropped it less than one point. So anyway, I'm pretty well assured that the hormone therapy is no longer effective for me, and I'm looking for a new procedure. And one of the other things in the back of my mind, and I've heard a lot of this this morning, was that Why is it that as we get older, our PSA declines, but our prostate cancer rises? And so I told my urologist that when he finally decided that I had a deep trouble, I want to load myself up with testosterone. And I heard that comment here. I think Bob brought it up. So anyway, I'm at the crossroads here now. Crossroads, and I'm wondering where I go next.
Any more questions on active surveillance before we go to prevention?
Yeah, this isn't specifically about active surveillance, but I think it's a general interest. A couple, one or two people brought up diet. And I'm just going to suggest that this group get an expert to speak to us about, you know, supplements and things like that that we can take to slow the growth of prostate cancer.
Good, find me one, please.
Well, just in the Dr. Scholl's book, Invasion of Prostate Snatchers, and some of the articles he's written, I learned that there have been some definitive studies on things like turmeric, if I'm pronouncing that right, broccoli, the main ingredient in broccoli, green tea extract, and also pomegranate. And also he recommends lower your animal protein, get your protein as much as possible from vegetables. So there is some stuff out there. I think I personally have used this. I had the surgery. My PSA was 0.08 3 months later. For the next year or so, my doubling time was like every 4 months. Well, I changed to pretty much a vegetarian. I started taking some of these supplements. My last doubling time for my last two measurements was 9 months. But I think this is a great general interest to everybody. There's supplements that can slow the rate of growth for whatever your situation is. I mean, everybody needs to know that.
Yeah, just to stay with that, I realize she got her hand up. But
no, along, it's basically the same thing. I just want to know if you eliminated dairy. Have you tried to cut back on dairy?
I'll give you guys a real quick so answer these questions, because yes.
Along that line with diet, I've been following this for a good 5 years and long before that. In the early stages, there are some men who are able to make some dietary changes, and we all like to believe that we're in control. And so if, you know, we get our blender out and throw a lot of green things in it and stuff, that may make a difference. And if you can handle that for a while, that's great. However, just recently, and I believe it was in April, there was the American Cancer huge convention here in San Diego, some 48,000 people here talking cancer. And the head epidemiologist from Harvard, man who's, this is his entire career, and he's gone over some 1,500 studies, came out and said, you know what? It doesn't. We can't point to anything that makes a difference. If other than, you know, you're eating those charred steaks, and the only thing that was still left out is maybe they're looking at dairy with prostate cancer. So my view is, and the gentleman over there said, everything in moderation.
Thank you. I talked to Dr. Moyad. He has a book here on wellness. And he talked about this $30 billion industry, $30 billion on supplements. He has a book here where he reviews the promoting wellness, and he has details on what these various supplements can do positively as well as negatively. He says we would be very cautious about taking supplements unless you qualify to do so. It's a wonderful subject, and a lot of people have a lot of experience. But many of these supplements have never gone into double-blind studies in comparison to placebos and things like that. Okay, let's hear about a new technology. And you've tried many technologies. Let's hear about yours.
I think I'm on here. Not yet.
Yeah, I'm on now. You can hear me now, okay? All right, just to give you a brief rundown, many of you have heard my story. Many times. It all started with the problem in trusting the doctor. Born and raised in a farming community in Kansas, a doctor was a person who always believed and did whatever he said. when I was first diagnosed, when my PSA started rising, and my doctor, as usually happens, my general practitioner says he needs to see a urologist, I went to the urologist and he did what they all do, you need to do treatment. I thought I was pretty smart at the time and did a lot of research, but I couldn't overcome in my mind, I need to get that out of me. I couldn't get rid of that. And so that's what I did. I did surgery. I didn't check the qualifications of the surgeon that did it. I believed what he told me. I didn't do any testing beyond bone scans that told me that it wasn't anywhere but in the prostate, we thought. So I proceeded with the surgery in January 2003. And exactly 1 year after that, guess what happened? My PSA started climbing back again. So I went and looked at some of the reports, and the report that I got from the removal of the prostate, when they did the pathology of the prostate, it had already been outside the prostate. It was in seminal vesicles already before he did the surgery. But he did it anyhow. That's the lesson to be learned here, is that I did the biopsy. Obviously, it was a 3+4, not terribly exciting, but it was already outside. And that's the advantage of the lessons we're trying to get out to you in this group, is doing some kind of imaging to identify where it's located, so that you can identify exactly where it is, if you can handle it mentally, do what he's doing, watch it. If it begins to move, start to do something later. But in that meantime, all the time that you spent doing nothing, you haven't impeded your lifestyle. Because believe me, in almost any kind of treatment you take, it's going to affect your lifestyle one way or another. But nevertheless, the doctor then sent me to the next step. He sent me to a radiation oncologist, happened to be Dr. Eink, who's going to be speaking to us, by the way, in October, along with Dr. Munt. Happened to be at that time in the Sheriff's Hospital, and we started radiation treatment. I now know that to be called salvation radiation treatment. 33 treatments over a 6-week period. At the end of that, and by the way, my PSA after surgery was 0.1. And after radiation, it was 0.1. It had climbed back to 4 before I went into radiation. So external beam radiation was the old-fashioned kind. They aimed the beam kind of like what George had. Where the prostate was, thinking that it's going to kill off anything they might have left behind. That put my PSA back to 0.1. That stayed that way for about 15 months, and then guess what happened? PSA starts climbing again. That put me in a pretty nasty mental state, as you might guess, having failed twice. And a casual acquaintance said, I know this guy named Lyle LaRoche, runs a prostate support group. Go to one of their meetings and see if he can help you. And I did, went to the meetings. After the first meeting happened to be a guy talking about vegan diets, which caught my attention. And I did try it for a while and realized that that's really no way to live. You spend all your time preparing foods, honestly. Now, there's some people that do it, but the usual videographer, Bill Manning, is on the vegan diet and doing well. He's on active surveillance 4 years now, and credits that as being most of the reason that he's able to stave it off. Nevertheless, I settled on a Mediterranean diet. I eliminated the worst things in the world, at least to me, as a Kansan. My whole diet was meat, red meat, milk products. I eliminated those. I haven't had red meat in 6 years now. Not only took off 50 pounds, it changed my lifestyle, really, and I don't miss any of that stuff anymore. So, unfortunately, 15 months after the radiation, my PSA started coming back. When I joined the group here, got involved with Lyle, my PSA had come back to 4. And through the group, I found out about, number one, I had just retired, and I had to change insurance because the company wouldn't insure me anymore unless I wanted to pay very high sums. Through the group, I found out about what's the best policies to get through Medicare, and United Healthcare where I sell. All the time that I've been doing treatments, I've paid nothing for medical care. I have paid some significant sums along the way for drugs, but still, it was good advice. And through them, I learned the My Lifesavers, so that was being sent to the prostate oncology specialist up in Marina Del Rey. And we tend not to recommend doctors, but think about it. You got prostate cancer? Prostate cancer specialist? Oh yeah, that probably makes some good sense. So I became a patient of them in April 2007, and the alternatives for them were quite few, and still are. So I did hormone therapy. Started out first with Casodex, which was an unusual treatment, still is somewhat, where I went on 150 milligrams of Casodex, and that took my PSA down to about 0.2. And it kept me level. I did Avodart along with Casodex. It maintained me pretty good. But as we all like to try to do, as you heard Bob talk about, doing intermittent therapy, well, every time I went off of the Casodex, my PSA came back like gangbusters. In a 3-month period, it went from 0.3 to 10. So I got some angry stuff working on me. But I went back on Casodex, dropped back down, tried another holiday. In 3 months, it went from 0.4, I think at that point in time, to 15. So I got some angry guys working on me. And went on Casodex again, and what we find out is each time that I took a holiday, did something, went back on it, each time the low point was higher. So that means I was becoming resistant to the Casodex treatment. So I then started on Lupron, which I initially refused to do because I heard all the bad words about the side effects of Lupron. So I did the Lupron. Being a conservative accountant that I am, I said, I don't want a 3-month shot, I want a 1-month shot. I'm going to find out how I tolerate it. So I did the 1-month shot. And Dr. Lamb says, I want you to do something because there's no question that Lupron is going to be debilitating. You'll lose muscle mass. You may lose some memory. And for sure, you'll probably experience fatigue. But he says, I want you to get to the gym and do something serious. I don't like gyms. I'm not that social. He says, get to the gym and I'm going to tell you it works. So I did. Fortunately, I got a wife 3 miles from where I live. Did some training, initial training. Because of my foot problems, I can't do the treadmill stuff or weight training and so forth and cardiac. But they showed me what exercise would work for me. And I'll be doggone, I have absolutely no effects from Lupron. I don't have fatigue. I don't have cold sweats. I have occasional flushing, I call it, especially when I hit the sack at night. First thing at night, I'll feel a flush, and that's it. Now, the net result of that is, guess what? My heart got really happy too, because I go 6 days a week, a little over an hour every day. I alternate cardio with resistance training. My cardio is two different machines. It's the elliptical and the recumbent bike where you sit and pedal. I do that one day along with rowing. For some reason, I love rowing. I don't know why. In Kansas, we had no water. I don't know diddly crap about rowing. But that, for some reason, gets me out in that euphoric state where you're just, wow, I really feel good. And for some reason, it does that. I do that every day. On the resistance day, I work on 18 different machines to make sure I'm working all different kinds of muscles and so forth. So believe me, it works. And men mentioned diet, I know that helps, and I know exercise helps. And the proof of the pudding is not only is my cancer level remaining low, I've been on blood pressure medicine for about 30 years. And about 12 months ago, I asked Dr. Lyme, what do you think about if I stop doing that now that I'm on the job? And he says, well, ask your GP. He's not my general practitioner. So he says, okay, let's cut the prescription in half, see how you handle it for 3 months. No problem. My blood pressure stayed almost exactly 120 over 70. No matter what, when he took it, that's what it was. So I stopped altogether about a year ago. No longer blood pressure medicine. It's all because of the exercise and diet. So take that message home with you. Now, as I've been going along with Lupron, and again, I also tried the holiday with Lupron and found out, boing, the minute I went off Lupron, my PSA went back on Lupron, and it works fine. But we do think that I'm starting to develop a resistance to Lupron. So that broke the subject of Dr. Land again talking to me about, 6-8 months ago about this newly approved treatment called Provenge. And if you haven't heard about it, we've got another gentleman that's done it up there. He told me about it. I'd read a lot about it, especially during the approval process, and it came out with the answer to the studies that they did that allowed it to be approved by the FDA was that it extended life by 4 months in the clinical test. Well, that didn't impress me a whole bunch, but you have to, the engineers understand it a lot better than I do, because you're doing a condensed period of time on people, so the 4 month survival can be a heck of a long time for some of the guys. That's all I can make out of it. That same life extension, it applies to the other new drugs that have been recently approved, the Zytiga, you've heard about, which is super Lupron. Xtandi, which is super Casodex, all of those got approved because it extended life roughly 4 months. So it all means the same. Now the problem with the Provenge information is that there doesn't seem to be any visible evidence that's working. That was a detriment in my opinion, in the way I looked at things. You know, I'm an accountant, it's a debit or a credit. It can't be somewhere in between. What Dr. Lamb finally got to me and said that, do you take a flu shot? I meant Provenge, and I failed to mention in the beginning. It bolsters your immune system. That's what it does. And he said, do you take a flu shot? I said, yeah. Do you get the flu? No. Then why wouldn't you want to do Provenge? It jacks up your immune system. I said, well, okay, what about that? Should we do it? He says, well, you can't. I said, wait a minute, I'm confused. Well, you have to, the rules on the FDA approval are you have to have failed hormone therapy before you can do Provenge. There have been just enough slight movement in like Lupron PSA tests, which were about 0.3. That he was able to justify getting me the Provenge treatment. So I did the treatment starting the 1st of April. My mentality has always been with Provenge is the logic of it really makes sense. Kick up your own immune system to help your body fight cancer. Okay. The detriment is there's just really no physical evidence that it's working other than you live longer. Well, if you live longer, was it because of that or something else? I don't know. So the answer then becomes, why not? Why not do it? So I did it. The treatment consists of three separate sessions. Each session is twofold. Session number one, I go to the American Red Cross in Kearney Mesa, and they withdraw the blood over a period of they circulate the blood and withdraw white blood cells over a period of 4 hours. So you're sitting there for 4 hours, a needle in each arm, and the blood circulating through your body into a machine that's you're right beside. And you cannot move your arms because it's a 16-gauge stainless steel needle, meaning it doesn't flex, so your arms are static. He's shaking his head, grinning at me. But they have a screen in front. I watched movies while I did it, so it wasn't all that bad. Then that. The blood draw then is sent up to Seal Beach to a factory or a plant that purifies the blood. I was invited over a year ago to go see that facility, by the way. It's pristine, as you might I guess, huge facility. That facility purifies the blood and adds what's called a dendritic cell to your blood. And the dendritic cell is the thing that's supposed to jack up your own immune system. So within 3 days of having it drawn, it has to come back into your body, and it only comes back into your body by infusion from your prescribing doctor. So you have to go back to whatever doctor prescribed it. So that would be Dr. Lamb up in Marina Del Rey. So back up, I did my blood draws always on Friday. On Monday, I went up to Marina Del Rey, sat in my comfortable chair, got the infusion. Not a traumatic process at all, other than the thing I noticed, the bag that they drew for me looked like it was well over a quart. What I got back was a little tiny bag. And I thought, well, hell, I need a refund. But that's what I got back. The infusion process, they give you Benadryl first, just as a precaution. The infusion, the whole process is less than an hour in that setting. And absolutely, the first treatment, absolutely no side effects. 2 weeks later, you go back and do the same cycle again. No problems. I got it. I don't know if you experienced it. But while I'm sitting there getting the infusion, the nurse at jail told me that some guys feel chills. Are you feeling cold? It's one of the second infusion, some guys start to have that problem. No, I'm fine. And maybe the mention of it, I don't know. So she tossed more blankets on me. Suddenly, I'm like, I'm in Kansas going to the outhouse in the middle of the winter. I'm really, really shaking. She said, it'll be gone in 20 minutes. And by golly, she was right. So that was it. That was the only reaction I had. And I said, usually the second treatment, that if you're going to have a reaction, that's when it happens. I went to the treatment number three cycle, no issues, infusion, no problems. However, the evening after that, at home, I started feeling like you do before you get the flu, a little dumpy, felt a little bit of chills. The next day, I felt like really I had the onset of a cold, and so I just did nothing. I didn't even go to the gym, and that's something for me. And the next day, it was gone. Poof. End of report. So that's all that happened. So I'm happy I did it. What I found out, interestingly enough, is they don't take your PSA test after the first infusion. They take it starting the second test, and both the second time and the last time, my PSA was down slightly. Well, that makes me feel real good, okay? So I'm happy I did it. I brought back with me some information. There's DVDs about Provenge. It's not for everybody. You've got to get your head into it and decide whether it's the right one thing for you to do. I think you probably went through the same process. I'm happy I did it, and I'll keep you up to date on almost how long I live. As long as you see me at the meetings, it worked, right? Yeah, right. There you go. And I want to mention also, in the same vein, before we go on any further, that coincidentally, and I don't know these people, but they're, forgot their name, wrote it down. Bavarian Nordic.
Yeah,
I've got, wait a minute, please. Well, let me finish, if you would. If you can, you wait until I'm done? Okay, thank you. They sent me some information that they are doing research on immunotherapy, not related to Provenge whatsoever, and they've got some clinical trials starting, and so. These brochures are over there. You can pick it up and you can start those clinical trials or get involved with them if you want. I don't know any more than I've just told you. You can go on the website. It's on there.
Does anyone know that in the last 6 months, I know that there were two big labs who were trying to develop biomarkers to test Provenge. Does anyone know the results of that? Anything that's going on?
The only thing further that I know that's been done, Lyle, is they've got some more studies going. Now they give you Provenge along with all other treatments you're doing. In the very beginning, you have to stop all your treatments before you started Provenz. But now it's along with any other treatment. And what they're discovering is that if you do Provenz along with, in my case, Lupron, it adds to the effectiveness of the treatment you're already on.
Gene,
they are discovering that.
Okay, thank you, Gene. We need to have some time for a breakout session, so we'll allow three questions on Provenz.
I just want to ask how long you've done Lupron before.
3 years.
Just 3 years?
Yes.
Okay. Question on Provenz.
Gene, how long do you intend to wait before, or do you to go on to take a second treatment of Provenz? Is there a,
no.
Is there a time frame?
I'm done. The treatment itself is the three separate sessions that I've talked, and as yet, that's the end of the report. They're doing some studies now that, well, can you come back 5 years later and add to the pie? They don't know yet.
Okay, are there any tests, since PSA is not a good indicator, are there any tests to tell you how you're doing?
No.
That's the mystery so far.
That's why I resisted.
As long as you keep showing up, you're doing well.
That's right.
That's going to be our measure. Any other questions? Okay, we're going to have a breakout section.